before we start. I do see a lot of red buttons, which I'm supposedly not to press, right?
Exactly. So these are emergency buttons.
Yeah.
That in case of failure and of, yeah, something is doing not the right job, then we have to push it, yeah, to shut it down rapidly.
I'm a little triggered, of course.
Yeah, this would be my.
I love it.
I don't want to press it.
Yeah, no, so please avoid it for this time.
Won't do that.
Please avoid it for this time. Did he warn you before or after you pressed it?
Before.
Melena. It's so funny because I have exactly the same intrusive thought.
Right? Right.
So,
would you call it intrusive? I mean, when you see a red button, you just want to press it.
It's like he's calling you from afar, like, press me.
Exactly.
But so where were you recording? Because from what you're telling me, it could be a space shuttle.
So that was me test driving a vehicle that has been modified by Bosch engineers to try their latest technology. So it was a test vehicle.
Intriguing. So we'll find out in a little bit if you were able to control yourself facing these emergency buttons.
or whether or not Bosch expert Thomas Friedrich, who was in the car with me, had to press them. Cliffhanger.
From know-how to wow. The Bosch Global Podcast.
Dear listeners, welcome to a very special From Know-How to Wow episode. So, something new, this episode has two parts.
Mm-hmm, a double feature. So a warm welcome from me as well. We have a lot to tell you about great engineering, so let's go.
Melena, when you choose the car you're driving, what made you prefer one model over another?
I do have a confession to make, first of all, because I do not even own a car. Never have.
Wait. Just to make it very clear, you do have a driver's license though, right?
I do.
Okay.
I do, but
okay.
I never bought a car. I never chose a car. So I'm sharing a car with my husband. It's a company car. But we're switching a lot. So I guess like every 6 to 12 months, we're switching cars. He's working in the automotive industry. So
okay.
It's a perk, I guess. It's kind of fun. But for the vehicle, for the car we're driving at the moment, we decided for a battery electric vehicle.
Okay.
We definitely wanted to drive electrically. So that was important. And when having a toddler, space is also super important.
Okay. So if I understand well, you guys are more in or directed towards one brand. So I don't know if you're the right person to ask, seeing as you've never owned a car, never bought a car, but do you feel any difference between one brand to another?
Well, I mean, I guess I'm really not the expert, but I do think it's very important for a lot of people. And there is actually a German word for that, which is Fahrgefühl.
Right. And I think it's important to note that this should not be confused with Fahrvergnügen, which many English speakers might know from one brand's advertising campaign.
Mm-hmm.
So coming back to your word Fahrgefühl. So Fahrgefühl is the driving experience of one particular model.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How it makes you feel as a driver. And I think that's why you test drive a car, right? To see what the Fahrgefühl is like.
So our Bosch colleague, Enrico Haberkern, calls this the DNA of a car manufacturer.
Every single car manufacturer has a very specific understanding of what their DNA is.
In the past, the DNA depended a lot on the components that were built into a car. So mainly the engine and its performance. But that's become less relevant because with the transition to e-mobility, there's not that much of a difference between the behaviors of different electric drives.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you're absolutely right. We've touched on that on the show before. Manufacturers of electric vehicles need new ways of injecting their DNA into cars, so they need new differentiating features.
So listeners, this is a little bit of a special episode for me because it was our live episode in Berlin. But if you want to find those episodes, look for our shows about open source software for the third automotive revolution, or our little episode called Make Cars More Software Driven from my colleagues, Double Christians from ITAS. So that's what it's all about, software. And software can modify a car so that it evokes the specific brand identity.
Software-defined Fahrgefühl, right?
Exactly.
Can we say that?
We can say that.
But what's different in this episode? Since we last talked about it, our engineers and developers have been hard at work. And now they've been releasing and previewing the first products. And I got to try them.
To say I'm jealous, Melena, is an understatement.
Oh, rightly so. Seriously, it was so much fun. I can tell you that.
So what we'll share today and in the next episode will be a very exclusive look at some of the newest developments. Enrico's department at Bosch, our expert today, who's the product owner for vehicle motion features at Bosch. Enrico's department at Bosch is called Vehicle Motion Management. They manage the behavior of cars by software, and they're following new approaches to do it.
With vehicle motion management, we are rethinking the way on how we are developing software to tackle different vehicle motion tasks. And this basically means that we are developing our software in a new way by combining different kinds of actuators that we have as of today to basically help the end user experience all different kinds of vehicle driving situations in the best possible way. That's what we're doing.
And actuators, just to explain that briefly, meaning the hardware, so the components of a car that physically change its trajectory.
We're talking about the electric drives, the brakes, the steering, basically all those things. Mm-hmm. And when he says they want to combine different actuators, that means the brakes and the motor, for instance, should work together.
That sounds like more collaboration under the hood. I like that.
Maybe Enrico can explain it a different way.
In the past, software was always developed coming from the hardware, from the actuator. Specifically, in my background, coming from the brake. So we looked at the brake and tried to understand what we could do from a brake perspective for the vehicle to then basically realize a specific task for the driver itself. Now, with vehicle motion management, we are first looking at what the driver actually wants to do in the car, basically coming from the use case, from the user experience, trying to understand, secondly, then what the car needs to do in order to realize the target that the driver puts in. And then we are trying to understand how the software needs to shape or influence the different actuators to realize the specific driving task.
It's really no longer as simple as press the brake pedal and then activate the hydraulic brakes. Instead, pressing the brake sends an electronic signal to a control unit where algorithms decide what's the best way of decelerating the car given the current situation.
Mm-hmm. Because I might be driving on snow or on gravel or on the Autobahn, and in each case, different styles of braking may be preferential.
Or as, you know, we are discussing, inject some brand identity.
We can calibrate the behavior of the pedal based on specific requirements we get from our customers, and therefore very specifically not only realize a certain behavior that we intend to provide to the end user, but also implement a very specific DNA for each and every car manufacturer. There's a lot of possibilities that we see by combining these different actuators into one single driving task. And this is clearly noticeable for you.
It is clearly noticeable for you. I can confirm that.
Well, tell us about trying these features in practice, Melena, who has tested everything.
Yes, let me do that. Thanks for asking. So I did a little field trip to Renning, which is just a quick trip from where I live, to our Bosch test track. And I've never been there before, so that was very exciting.
I have.
Oh, you have? It is pretty cool, isn't it? I mean, the Bosch test track. We have our very own test track. And waiting for me there were a Thomas Friedrich and a car that Bosch engineers equipped with just a few exciting upgrades. Yeah.
Just the brake system is the newest brake system from Bosch. The powertrain, so the electric drive units, so other words for that is e-axle, We have two in this vehicle, one for the front, one for the rear. So we have an all-wheel drive vehicle, and those electric drive units or e-axles are from a competitor. But the control unit which supervises those two electric axles is from Bosch as well.
That's interesting to hear, because that's also something Enrico talked about. Bosch software doesn't just work with Bosch hardware.
If you want to realize software business, the software business can't always be dependent on the hardware business. So when we understand ourselves as a software company, this also means that our software has to work with hardware from other suppliers. It's our understanding of ourselves as a software company.
Enrico says the vehicle motion management software is hardware agnostic. All inputs and outputs are in a standardized format. And as long as the hardware is compatible with this format, it basically just works.
Mm-hmm.
So back to you and your test drive, Melena.
Okay, let's see. Shall we start?
I was in this car on this Bosch test track to try one specific feature, which is called e-brake to zero.
Shall we give it a try?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So what do I do?
So now you have to press the D button for drive with the foot on the brake pedal.
Together with the brake pedal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you're good to go. So you can just turn and we can go on the test track.
Okay, let's drive to the test track.
The idea is to use the electric drive to brake instead of the hydraulic brakes.
But that's what electric vehicles do, right? I mean, helps with saving energy too.
Yeah, but usually only up to a certain point before the hydraulic brakes kick in. And then what happens?
I'm going to let you tell me.
There is this little jerk that your body makes. You know that when you're braking and you have that little nod
where your torso is moving forward a little bit and then back into the seat.
Exactly. Because with a new feature turned off, I did experience exactly that.
Okay, yeah, I already felt that because you turned it off. And as soon as the vehicle comes to a complete standstill, we have that little nodding that people might know where you just jolt forward a little.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Oh, again, it's still switched off. I come to a complete standstill. Oh, yeah.
Let's switch it on.
All right, so here we go. E-brake to zero.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, again, the feature is turn on. I accelerated to 50 kilometers per hour. I released the accelerator pad. And the vehicle comes to a complete standstill very smoothly. Oh, without that little jerk in the end, we come to a complete standstill.
Yeah, exactly. So it's very comfortable. We hear no noise from the brakes, no jerk, no everything.
And we were pretty fast. It was even 60 kilometers per hour.
Yeah, but the speed is not the limiting factor. So you can also do it.
Can I just turn and do it again?
Yeah, you can do it.
Melena, you seem to be really blown away by this. Mm-hmm. Does it really feel that different?
Honestly, I read about e-brake to zero beforehand and I came prepared. Turns out I was not prepared for this. I thought the effect would be kind of small, you know, just a little nice to have, increasing the comfort in the car a little. I mean, am I bothered by the jerk from standard braking? I don't know, not really. But then I was really, really surprised how nice that felt. And I just saw myself in terrible rush hour traffic every day, stop and go, stop and go, stop and go, and braking all the time, and how much nicer that could feel.
Well, the software functionality can probably not make rush hour nice, but definitely nicer.
Mm-hmm.
And I can definitely see that as well.
You can try to decelerate even harder, so the smoothness is even more noticeable. Yeah, a little bit harder.
A little harder.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. Ooh, yeah. You have that expectation, though, that nodding, that it'll come, but it doesn't.
Yeah.
Really, I loved that.
No more headbanging.
Only voluntarily. Yes, when the right music is playing.
You mean when we're playing the right music that Steph and Jeff like?
Yep.
But seriously, if e-brake to zero is such a great experience, it makes you wonder, why don't we already have it? Why is it not built into, you know, every electric car? And Enrico has a couple of answers to that. And number one, it's technically challenging.
When we talk about e-braking to zero, you have to keep in mind that there are two major aspects to it. We have torque and we have the rotational frequency.
Rotational frequency defines the forward movement, the speed, and torque is the decelerating force.
So you always have to find the sweet spot between rotational frequency and torque, and you have to bring both to zero to have your car actually stand still. So how does this work? As soon as we have a torque demand, which basically is you remove your foot from the accelerator pedal, this is your demand, and then basically your car is slowly starting to decelerate, right? And as soon as the rotational frequency is almost at zero, like we're talking about a range between 5 kilometers per hour or 3 kilometers per hour, then the torque is being ramped to zero. Meaning whenever, as soon as the torque is ramped to zero, the friction brake or the brake basically takes over and is in the end just holding the vehicle.
And just because I know we have some real nerds in the audience who know their stuff, when Enrico says the torque is being ramped to zero, that's only true if the car is on a level plane. When there is an incline, the math is different. But of course, e-brake to zero still works.
Mm-hmm. And I tried that as well. On the test track, I tried it on a slope going uphill, and it worked just as nicely.
So it's quite sophisticated to achieve the smooth stopping with the electric drives alone, especially when you keep in mind that it has to work in all kinds of different situations.
You have to go to specific testing grounds to test it on low mu, meaning on bad road conditions. You have to test it on high mu, meaning on very good road conditions. You have to see how it performs. Do you always reach this target state of having your rotational frequency and your torque on zero, or is there always a slight gap? So there's a lot of adjustment of this software that needs to be done in the end.
And this leads me to the second reason why something like e-brake to zero might be harder to implement than you'd think. And that is one of Bosch's core competencies, safety.
It's easy to program an algorithm as a prototype, but then developing it, ensuring that whatever happens to the functionality, there always is a backup. Understanding how this functionality is also communicating to other functionalities and what happens if there is a critical driving situation and another functionality has to take over. And this is something which I think is often forgotten when we talk about feature development. You really have to make it work in a complete ecosystem.
Enrico says third parties, maybe even the open source community, might be able to develop new functionalities for software-defined vehicles. But the people at Bosch's Vehicle Motion Management Unit can test those algorithms thoroughly and make sure they're safe.
And I can confirm that there are even more exciting functions. E-brake to zero is just one of a couple of new functionalities that I was able to test. I saved another test drive of a different functionality for the next episode, so stay tuned, everyone.
In our next episode, we will also dive deeper into what it means to implement this new approach to, you know, controlling the behavior of a vehicle. But we'll leave it at this for today. And as Melena has said, stay tuned for more next month.
Talk to you next month, Shuko.
From know-how to wow. The Bosch Global Podcast.
All right.
Let me give it one more try, and then you're released. But it's fun. It's really fun. Again, accelerating 250, 60 kilometers per hour. And again, I brake a little harder. Like that?